them had
coaches?
Had been abused by the coaches, yeah. The coaches, you know, there's
Oh, honey.
some of them are swimmers, and so the coaches would go into the locker rooms, and but there was a power thing happening because these guys were also the ones that were getting them ready for the Olympics and getting them ready to get into Stanford. So as a woman, and certainly my own abuse history has this too, but I did not have quite that same power experience in my own sexual abuse history. But what happens for a lot of women athletes is the guy who's doing the abusing also has all the string. He has all the strings. So he can make, he's the one that's coaching you. He's the one that's letting you getting into these races or recommending you for these schools. And so you out him and your whole career could fall apart. And so there's a lot of pressure. And you think these kids are young. I mean, we were young. We were
right.
just out of college, out of high school. So,
right.
But the good news is, you know, I don't know how they found each other predates me, but they did find each other, and they went the extra mile for each other. They fought for each other's freedom, and I think that to me is really hopeful. I think the church really stands in a place to acknowledge that all of these young women are experiencing some form of painful trauma, and it's becoming much worse as more porn is there and there's more acceptance of it. There's victimization going on at extremely high levels. The rest of the world is basically saying, if that morphs you, who cares, right? If you look at the whole genderbread thing and you're like, well, if you want this now because of that, whatever, just take what you want. But they don't say, all right, let's heal the trauma. Let's go back and see what got you to this place.
And people have a lot of different pain relief mechanisms.
Yeah, which, they sure do.
You know, that they can, that could fill in that exact same slot. For a lot of people, it's, you know, some kind of food comfort, you know, that they'll turn to, right? I mean, that's probably the most common one in our culture. You know,
right, or Netflix or something, right?
whatever it is,
the thing. I'm kind of glad that mine's considered taboo because it gets me to Jesus faster, right? If it's just watching Netflix until 3 o'clock in the morning, I can do that for a long time before someone says, hey, you, get off the TV, right?
But let's go back to your husband. Just one last little point about your husband. If you were in a relationship with another woman, it's not clear to me that another woman could have done that redirect as quickly and as easily. And the reason I bring that up, well, there's a number of reasons I bring that up. We know from the data that same-sex relationships between women are the least stable of all relationships, whether you call them cohabiting, whether they're in a country where they're legally married. You know, legally married lesbians are that's the most unstable relationship. Generally, a lot more violence as well. A lot of violence, a lot of instability in lesbian relationships. So people aren't ready for that. They think, well, the men are probably more unstable, but no, the guys can blow stuff off. Whereas with two women, you know, things will.
Well, and I have been privy to some of those relationships, and there is an enmeshment there that happens that's so complete that the idea of detaching and is actually life threatening to some of them. Like, I can't live without you. You are what I must have. And so a lot of the violence comes from, are you going to leave me? Cause I'm going to kill you if you leave me. So there's a lot of that. In fact, I had a friend who that actually happened in her college, that a lesbian couple broke up and the one actually murdered the other. No, you can't go. And having been in that relationship, I think one of the things that is really hard to wrap your head around is that the nature of same-sex attraction amongst women, I don't know that it's the same for men, but amongst women, is that there is sort of a deep cling that happens. It's almost a mother-daughter cling. Not that one's the mother and the other's the daughter, but they're both the mother and the daughter to each other. So if I were in a lesbian relationship and this were to happen, I would return to my lesbian lover for all the comfort. She wouldn't say, oh no, go to Jesus. She would love it because she would be, I'd be all over her, right? And I think that that's one of the things that's really hard for like I had a conversation with a friend of mine the other day. I said, you know, straight people do not know what it feels like to be gay. So it's almost like you can't speak into it and say, oh, don't worry, that's fine, because you don't know what you're saying. You don't know what you're affirming. You're assuming that how you feel towards a man, a woman, a straight woman assumes that how she feels towards a man is how gay women feel towards women. And they're assuming that that feeling is the same, but it's not. The nature of the relationship is not the same. The nature of the relationship is significantly more hungry for women to women. It's a search for self in another person. I don't search for myself in my husband. I become more of who I am because of him, and he becomes more of who he is because of me. I give to him and he gives to me, but I don't find myself in him, right? And a lot of broken heterosexual relationships have a little bit of that same element to it. So, you know, these movies you see about obsessive opposite sex relationships that are just obsession, that's a little closer, really, to what is happening in same-sex relationships than a traditionally heterosexual relationship. Does that make sense?
No, this is a really important point that you just made, Christy, because people do have this sense that that gay and straight are the same thing except with different plumbing parts.
Yeah.
And that's not particularly significant. And that turns out not to be the case, because being in a we're embodied creatures, and we're sexually embodied. You know, I am a woman, you are a woman, my husband is a man. And that's not an incidental fact about who we are, you know. The sex nature of our being is something that permeates all of us. And so if there's some kind of distortion in that, that's a problem. And that's a lot of what you were dealing with. But also it means that the character of the relationship is not as similar as you might assume that it is, you know. And so, tell me more about that.
Well, yeah, I think these signs that say love is love, that is like the biggest deception out there. That, first of all, attraction is attraction, maybe, right? But love is not like this idea that the love I have because I'm attracted to this woman and I'm going to make her mine and we're going to be together forever. That is not the same thing that's happening when I look at my husband. It's interesting because I told you the story about me putting my hand on the shoulder of this other woman and feeling like my soul was going to her. Fast forward, I don't know, 20 something years, probably 20. And my husband, not yet my husband, comes out to, I was a missionary in China. My husband comes out to China to visit. It's a long story, but there's this moment where we hadn't been dating. Technically, I hadn't really been attracted to him. There was no history there. But there's this moment where somebody has taken a picture of us and at a pagoda or something. And I put my hand on his shoulder and I thought to myself, this is a man I could get behind. And I was like, what the heck was that thought, right? I pulled my feet. I'm so surprised by it. But I pulled my hand off his shoulder. He put his hand on my shoulder. They have the picture. I actually have it on my wall. But it was this moment in time where I was like, this is a man who I want to become all he is meant to be. And he wants me to become all I am meant to be. And it wasn't until years later that I saw the contrast between hand on the shoulder and hand on the shoulder, right? The hand on the shoulder when I'm young and with this woman was, I'm losing myself to her, right? Whereas the hand on the shoulder with my husband, my soon to become husband, was, this is a man who I believe can be an incredible man and I want to help him get there. And I am for him, and I will add my femininity to his masculine self to help him become more of who he's called to be. And I honestly still feel that way about him. I still think, oh, I am your number one fan. I am your advocate. I give myself to you for you to become all that you are. And he does the same for me.
Right.
And that dynamic, that truly heterosexual dynamic, where he brings his masculinity, I bring my femininity, that really does create something that simply cannot be with the absence of one or the other of the genders. So two men together cannot do that. Two women together cannot do that. It has to be a masculine and a feminine. And what we provide for our daughters is a masculine and a feminine family fabric that they can stand on with confidence. And they get it. They get that we are not the same. In funny, hilarious ways, but also in really important ways. And they get, my daughters get that they are a girl, a me version, and not a him version. They carry traits of him, but they don't, but they are women and they know it. And I think that that fabric that exists in the heterosexual, in a healthy heterosexual relationship. Now, I think a lot of problem we have is that there's not a lot of healthy heterosexuality out there. So obsession is obsession. Like I could put a poster out in my front yard that says love is love, and I cross it out and write obsession is obsession. You know, desire is desire, right? But love is not, that is not the same thing as love. I'm not going to do that because I live in a liberal neighborhood. I get my house.
Yeah, I was going to say the homeowner association would flip out over that probably. But point taken.
Yeah.
I just wanted to comment on that, that like I said, I've been married to the same man for 40 years, and only recently have I actually felt the reality that I experience my femininity in relation to his masculinity, you know. And I see him doing manly stuff. I consider it manly stuff when he's fixing stuff. Okay. He's one of these guys. If you're an engineer, you know, guys like this, he was an engineer coming down the birth canal, you know, I mean, he's just, Mr. Fix It, you know, that is his identity. And I'm getting off looking at the back of his neck while he's fixing the refrigerator. I'm thinking, that is so strange. But it's true. You know, it's like the word, I guess, is appreciation. Appreciation, support, all of that is part of it. But it isn't about, it's me in relation to him. It's not just me. It's me in relation to. And I think you, that's John Paul's theology of the body, which I think is something that we both have in common. Yeah. But you can't get to me in relation to you as a good if you're starting from the premise of equality. Like that's where feminism derails us. Right. Yeah. And you also, I think you can't get there from a position of radical individualism. And for my husband and me, that was our particular problem because we were both libertarians. We both had kind of Ayn Rand problems, you know. You know, and if you think you're supposed to be independent and tough and all that kind of stuff, you're not going to get to that.
Yeah.
I'm more of who I am because I'm in relation to you.
Right.
And
right.
being in relation to you makes me more of myself. It's a lot harder to get to that point. So
anyway, I agree.
Continue. I want to hear more.
Well, I am a bit, it wasn't until later, much later, that I encountered John Paul II's theology of the body. And, I really do love the language. It's the language I use now when I teach youth. I'm in a beautiful situation where I get to teach biblical theology to youth. And I talk a lot from the materials of John Paul II's theology of the body. And I think one of the things that he talks about is this idea of being a gift to the other and then receiving the gift of the other. So I talk to my students about awe and how like God created an awesome world, and we want to at an early age develop this sense of awe and wonder, because when I am looking at my husband doing whatever it is, it could be anything, it could be he's a gardener so he loves to garden, so it could be watching him garden, it could be even just having him work, he works very hard because we own a company and so it's hard work, I can look at him and I'll have these moments of just awe where I'll be like, you are an amazing creature. And that is not the same as I need you, I want you, I have to have you. It's much more honoring really to him.
Yes.
And it's much more, it comes from a place of being solid in who I am. So that's not to say that I don't desperately need him at times. And I do desperately need him at times. We live life together, we grieve together, we suffer together, like that's life, but there's, it's not, our relationship isn't fueled by that. Our relationship is fueled by this kind of amazement that God would bring us someone, like he says this all the time, he's like, I'm still amazed that God brought you to me, I just can't believe it, like you're, that's an amazing thing, you're an amazing creature, which is not the same thing as, oh baby, you're so hot. It's more like wow. And I think that we get confused when we say things like love is love. We get a lot of things confused. Same-sex attraction is not love. When you say, I have fallen in love with a woman, I say, I've fallen in love with a woman. That is not this exactly the right language to use. I really, really want this woman and I want to join with her and I want to have a relationship with her because I'm obsessed with her and I can't stop thinking about her all the time. We call that love, but that's not really love. And again, that's what I love about John Paul II, because he defines love as the gift of self and the desire for the best of the other. And that is a different feeling than what I'm experiencing same-sex attraction. I don't long for the best of the other. So
that's an amazing set of things that you've said there, because, and that point of his, it's new. He brings it alive in a new way. But the idea of that definition of love is very old in the Catholic tradition. Yeah. To will and to do the good of the other. Love is fundamentally not a feeling. You know, love is actually it's a decision of the will. Love is a choice. Right. Love is a decision. You know, that's all part of it. You've said a lot of extremely insightful things here. I know a lot of people are going to be blessed by this interview. There's one topic that we've kind of hinted at, and I want to give you a chance to speak directly into it. And that is the current idea that's current and popular in some circles about being a gay Christian, and various other kinds of language about that. Different ways of describing the walk with Christ while experiencing same-sex attraction.
Right.
Help people, if you would, first of all, kind of define what some of those different, I guess you'd call them movements or trends.
Right.
If you could define those just a little bit and then give us your thoughts about them, because I have an idea that you have something powerful to say about that issue, all the issues that are wrapped up in those definitions.
Yeah, there's a growing trend. So it used to be that you could either be a gay Christian and do what you want, like God doesn't say homosexuality is wrong, right? That was one way of looking at same-sex attraction. Or God doesn't want you to be gay, you should go get that fixed. Kind of when I became a Christian, that was sort of the only two choices really that were out there. And so we, you know, I was in the get me fixed stage, not at all understanding what I've already talked about, which is transformational process that we're really talking about, which honestly is a transformational process for every Christian. So really, yes, when we give our lives to Christ, we got to give him all of it. And all of our history, all of our trauma, all of our joy, all of our pain, all of our hopes, all of it. And I think to hold any of that back is to not really be following Jesus. That's not to say that I do that. I think that that's the life journey. Is to allow him to tell us the next thing that he wants us to give to him. But those were sort of the two paths. Since then, there's been some developments where there's an idea that, and there's a long history as to why this path has developed. But right now there's a growing movement of people who say, I'm just a gay Christian, which means I believe in the traditional view of marriage, but I don't feel attracted to the opposite sex. So I'm just going to be celibate. And celibate can have a lot of different meanings in a lot of different circles. But what it's doing is it's creating this little comfortable niche of, I'm a gay Christian. And specifically, I'm not talking about I'm a gay Christian, I'm acting out on those feelings. I'm talking specifically, I'm a gay Christian who believes in a traditional view of sexuality, so I'm of heterosexuality, so I'm not going to follow these feelings. That is a new-ish group of people, and it's growing quickly. And there's a real sadness in that. I feel very, very sad about that, because I feel like when I look at the gender-bred man, if that's something you've ever referred to, this idea that we're born with a gender, we're born with a sex, but all of the feelings and how we present ourselves and how we feel about ourselves, all of that is additional or separate from our sex, the male, female that were born. So I can be born a female, but present as a male, or want men, or feel like a man, or want women. Like, there's all these different things. And to me, what Christ is saying is, come to me, all you are weary and heavy laden, and I will integrate you. I will bring all of those into their proper order. When we say, I'm going to just be a gay Christian, what we're saying is, I don't want to be integrated. I'm not interested in having this be submitted to Jesus and letting him change me and transform me. Instead, we're just holding on to this broken space, saying, I'm going to be identified by my broken space. And I think there's real tragedy in that for lots and lots of reasons. I think the lost life in that perspective is really, really sad. When I think about what it means for me to be a wife, and I don't mean like I'm the little housewife of the 50s. I mean, I get to be a wife. I get to be someone who fights for a man and fights for a family and nurtures my children and all of this life that comes from that. I think I would hate for someone to say, I will just never have that. I'm choosing just to sit here in this more comfortable space. That being said, I do think the reason it's growing is because at the core of same-sex attraction really does lie a longing to know oneself. There's some place where I've cut off from myself and I now no longer belong. There's this longing for belonging. I think, frankly, everybody has a longing for belonging. But for people who experience same-sex attraction and who are Christians, they don't belong in church. They're traditionally white because they're not heterosexual, so they can't go to the singles groups. There's all of those things that church does to promote family, rightfully so, but they don't belong there. And so they're looking for a place to belong. And so there's this desire. So they come together because we all belong together. We're the gay Christian club, right? I finally found a place where I belong. And that's the language you'll hear. I found family. I found like I belong here. And I feel like that it is a little bit incumbent on the church and our church communities to really embrace and love and know these people, because they do feel like they're second class citizens because they're not straight, and they're not a wife and a mother and all these things. And so I think there's a lot of dynamics at work, but it's tragic to me for a Christian who experiences same-sex attraction to put on the gay Christian t-shirt and let that be their life. God has more for us than that. And God, you know, there we can have an ethical conversation about whether or not it's immoral to do that. But I think I would rather say it's not life-giving. It's not going to bring you the freedom that Christ has for you. Christ died to set us free. And that doesn't mean all gay people should be married. Or, you know, I'm not saying that marriage is the answer. But it certainly is true that God wants to heal all of those things that have made it impossible for us to either identify with our own gender or be interested in the opposite gender. You look at my inability to love men, and God wants to heal that. Whether I get married or not, God wants to, that's half the population for crying out loud. Like God wants to heal that so that I can love men and relate to men in a way that isn't reactive and isn't afraid and isn't defensive and, you know, edgy. So I feel like that's a really important dynamic, that whether we're coming out of same-sex attraction or not, as we look at people saying, oh, I'm just a gay Christian, it breaks my heart at the embrace of the church of this choice of self-identification as a gay Christian. I think the church has dropped the ball, frankly, at saying, no, wait, Jesus has way more for you than I'm just a gay Christian.
Do you know, I think one of the problems is the widespread belief that people are born gay. Oh, yeah. And that gay is part of your identity, you know, and that gay is the new black, or being gay is like mm-hmm. being mm-hmm. left-handed or something like that. I hear these analogies all yeah. the time. Yeah. And in your particular case, in the case of literally every person I've talked to in this series, there is some wound that lies behind the same-sex attraction. They don't, people by and large don't believe they were born gay. You know, there's something else that's driving it. And my friend Elizabeth Wanning, whom you may know, made this statement, blew me away. She said, the born gay idea is the great redemptive narrative for the mm-hmm. LGBT community, because it excuses people in advance of having to address their own patterns of attraction. It excuses the parents from having to look at whether their family dynamics may have played a role in it. And so it lets right. everybody off the hook. But your point is that the cost of doing that is that you can't grow into the deeper possibilities of human relationship that God has in store for you, and that, and that's really your birthright as a man or as a woman.
Absolutely, that's
shut off.
Absolutely, absolutely. I totally agree. I think, yeah. I mean, I think the reality is, if you had asked me early in my process if I was born gay, I would have said, "Of course, I was born gay." My first full sentence was, "I wish I were a boy," right? I mean, if I were born 30 years later, you would not have this person in front of you. I'd be using different pronouns, right?
Right.
So, I think the reality is we're born into a family system, and it doesn't have to be a trauma. It could just be a family system where you don't quite belong. And you think, well, men are this way, but I'm not like that, so I must not be a man. Like, this is a really common problem for men, is they just don't measure up to the definition of masculinity. That doesn't have to be a huge trauma. It could just simply be, not that not belonging isn't a trauma. I think it is a trauma.
Yeah, I was going to say,
oh, I was sexually abused 45 times with my uncle. It's more like, I just was never at home in my skin or in my house. And that is a tragedy. And it's important to let Jesus have that tragedy and then speak to us, letting him tell us who we are rather than us telling us who we are or our family telling us who we are.
Mm-hmm. Or the advertising agencies telling us who we are. The further problem with the born gay idea is that it precludes the possibility of meaningful change. And I think something that I have, I think I'm observing this as a pattern. I could be all goofed up about this, but on the Roman Catholic side, we have an apostolate called the Courage Apostolate, which is a very beautiful thing. But they have traditionally always said, our goal is not to change people's sexual orientation. Our goal is to help people live chaste, holy lives. That's our goal. Mm. And some people do, I think, change their patterns of attraction, but that isn't the goal of the ministry.
Right.
And I feel like that maybe that was giving up too quickly in a way, or, you know, kind of limiting what we think is possible, maybe because we have this tradition within the Catholic Church of consecrated virginity as being a holy endeavor and so on and so forth. So there are probably some unique aspects on the Catholic side of the fence here that are driving that. But I do think that even among people who are sincerely trying to help, this is where I'm going with this, even among people who are Orthodox in their doctrine and sincerely trying to help, may be infected with this born gay idea more than they realize, you know, if they think, gosh, we can't really expect people to change their pattern. We can expect you to be chaste. Everybody can be chaste, but we can't expect that you're ever going to be straight, you know.
Right.
I'm really starting to wonder about that.
Yeah, I think that's a really, so there's some funny things that are happening. I think Desert Stream Ministries many years ago now, changed their language to Desert Stream Ministries, a ministry I'm involved with, that provides a ground and an environment for those seeking healing of what they now call unwanted same-sex attraction. So there's a lot in that sentence, healing of unwanted same-sex attraction. So we're talking about same-sex attraction being an indicator of an inner disorder, and Jesus wanting to go into that inner disorder and reorder it. So that statement right there is kind of loaded, to say that same-sex attraction is a symbol or a symptom of an inner disorder. I've already lost half the audience on that, because but if we can accept that that is true, similar to bulimia, I've been thinking about bulimia a lot lately, because it was like all the rage when I was young. I mean, not all the rage, but it was the up and coming anorexia and bulimia. And there it's like, it was easy to see there is an inner disorder that you, 35-pound, 5'10" girl, think that you are fat. Like, it's easy for all of us to say no, right? There's an inner disorder there. Well, same-sex attraction is similar. It's a disordered expression of what's going on, of affection. It's a disordered understanding. So when I'm attracted to a woman, it's a sign that something is disordered on the inside. And if I can accept that, which we used to be able to accept that more easily than we do now, well, then, you know, Katie bar the door, Jesus can do anything he wants. I can take that disorder and let Jesus reorder it however he wants. And it's going to be different with every person. The process will be different. The cause of the disorder will be different. Even the nature of this disorder will be different. It's quite different between men and women even.
Yes.
But being able to retain the language that says this is a disorder, what I'm hearing you say is, well, if we just drop that language out, we can say at least we're not having sex with somebody, right?
Right, thank goodness.
There are some women, there are two women, Rosaria Butterfield and Jackie Hill Perry, both have written books. They're both Protestant Christians, were living lesbian lifestyles. They both became Christians in different environments for different reasons. And both of them are now married with children. And it's interesting because they don't talk about their journey as a healing journey at all. They don't use that language at all. They talk about their journey as a surrender journey. Like, I'm just gonna do what God tells me to do. And he's told me not to live with this woman anymore. He's told me to burn all my porn. He's told me to, and I'm just gonna keep following God. And as they submit and submit and submit, and then they also have to submit, I can't hold bitterness against men. I can't close my heart to men. That's not God's way for me. And so do they end up in therapy? Oh, you bet. And do they end up having to process things? So they're going through this thing and they're never using these words of healing, which would be more kind of the path I have come from. But their process is essentially the same. They're just motivated by it differently and experiencing it differently, but they're experiencing the transformation of Christ through continual submission to his will for their lives. Now that takes some maturity to say, oh, I see that I hate men and God wants to do something about it. A lot of women don't realize they hate men. They just kind of hate men. They don't go, I hate men. They're like, oh, yeah. I'm just uncomfortable in the room when they're in here, right?
Just to be clear, these two women that you're describing, Rosaria Butterfield's name is familiar to me. The other name I'm not familiar with, but they would also be, they would not embrace the gay Christian idea. They would also say that that's a big mistake and a wrong path for people.
Yeah, they would. Yeah, they both would say to be a gay Christian is to define yourself according to a sin. And we don't want to be defined according to a sin. We want to be defined according to Jesus. So I am a daughter of the Most High God.
Yes, and I heard Rosaria Butterfield say one time that if I call myself a gay Christian, I'm saying, Holy Spirit, you can't touch this part. I give myself to you, but not that part. I'm hanging on to that, you know. And I feel like that's an indicator. Like if a person, anybody who might be listening to this or watching this, if you're trying to figure out whether you're side B or wherever, side X, or you know, wherever you fall into this thing, I think the red flag, the flag for you to follow is, am I hanging on to something that I shouldn't be hanging on to,
right?
You know, and however you, whether you view that as a healing or a surrender or, you know, some part of your, however you view that, that's the thing that you need to be alert to, that you're hanging on to something you should be hanging on to. I do want to give you a minute. We're coming to the end of our time, and I know you have, I want to be respectful of your time. I want to give you a chance to tell people just a little bit more about Desert Stream Living Waters ministry. Yeah. Because I think there's a lot of hope in that ministry for the people who are dealing with unwanted same-sex attraction, and also their family, their parents, their friends, their grandma. Speak into those people's needs, if you would, and tell us about Desert Streams.
Yeah, so Desert Stream Ministry started years ago, maybe in the 70s, by a man named Andy Comiskey, who came out of a gay lifestyle. He's a gay man, and he's like, God wants to do something with this, and I'm going to let him have it. And so he started support groups right away for gay men, and moved quickly to gay men and women, and then moved quickly to sexual and relational brokenness, because he realized that in the case of that the gay struggle is not exclusive to people who experience same-sex attraction. This rejection of self. Yeah, the rejection of self, the rejection of others, the internalization of trauma, the refusal to experience God's love and version in certain ways. And frankly, we can have trauma and respond to it in different ways. So for me, if I have sexual abuse, my response to sexual abuse is to hate men. Well, other women who experience sexual abuse, their response is to become extremely promiscuous, or their response is just to quietly sit off in the corner and be a little mouse and not ever talk. Like, all of us need healing from these things. So what Andy and Desert Stream Ministries has done is they've created a program called Living Waters that is a multi-week, 20-week, I believe it is, program in which we have prayer and teaching. And the way I describe it is we basically are removing the log jams wherever there is something that might be keeping you from receiving the redemptive love of Jesus in some area of your life. So that could include father wounds, mother wounds, something happening in your childhood, rejection of your femininity or your masculinity, all kinds of different things. And what it does is, I feel like it does two things at the same time. And it helps expose and remove some of these things, but it also gives us tools so that as we hit them later, no one's going to be healed in 20 weeks. I mean, maybe someone, but they're lucky. But what it does is it gives us tools to say, oh, this is what this is. So, you know, my husband and I both have extensive years ministering in this community. And so when I started bending towards this woman and my husband could say, well, of course you are. It's because he was trained through the Living Waters program. He knew. He's like, oh, yeah, that makes sense, right? So I think, so what Living Waters does is it provides just an avenue for people seeking healing, seeking freedom from same-sex attraction and other sexual brokenness. So I've led groups where I've had bulimics, and I had once somebody in my group who was a kleptomaniac, actually, and came in like, I can see that this is a relational problem, clearly, right? And so there, like, we have people with all kinds of different relational issues come in. Pornography is a big one. Broken marriages, breaking marriages that they want to save their marriage, they'll come in and seek healing. There's a couple of programs in addition to Living Waters where we offer support for families of people with same-sex relationships within the family. So parents is one group that we kind of minister to and just encourage and strengthen. We have a shorter program called Cross Current, which we actually are now doing in internationally. And that's been really fun because we do it virtually, and we have people from literally all over the world jumping in, seeking healing, seeking freedom from different areas of real sexual relational brokenness. I don't accept myself as a woman. I don't accept myself as a man. I'm struggling with porn, you know, all of the stuff. And so it's really a beautiful environment where people can be honest about their struggle, can open up to Jesus about why that struggle might be there and where Jesus might want to go in and do reparative work and transformational work. It's been pivotal in my life personally, but it's also really fun to see how God just really wants to free people. He's waiting at the door for us to say, yeah, you can have this. And it's not just, you can have my gay, but you can have my relationship with my mother. You can have my relationship with my father. You can have my, like for me, fear of pain was a big deal. And so you can have my fear of pain and I will come to you in that space. And just creating spaces for that freedom to be worked out, for that transformation to be worked out. That's really what Desert Stream does in every way.
And so if people want to get involved in this, do they just go to your website and send you an email and they find a group or something like that? Is that how
Yeah,
that
the Desert Stream Red site will have a bunch of different resources on it. And there's a lot that they're doing. The Cross Current is sort of an easy on-ramp to think, is this really something I want to get involved with? And so there's a lot of different resources in there. So I highly recommend it.
And just to give people a sense of this, because one of the things that we're interested in doing this whole project on ex-gay visibility is to show that this is not like a quirky thing. There are a lot of people, there are a lot of ex-gays out and about.
Lots and lots. How, and
would
lots.
You say... it seems to me Marco Casanova told us that about a third of the people in their programs, roughly about a third, would be people dealing with unwanted same-sex attraction because of all the other aspects that people are, you know, coming to deal with. So how many people go through your program, for example, in a year? How many people would you say go through the Desert Stream program? Just to give people some idea of the scope of this thing.
It's pretty big. So Desert Stream has programs all over the country. Marco would be the one that would know the actual answer to that question. I don't know the answer. I would only be guessing. But I will tell you that our online Cross Current, the last one we ran, had 99 people sign up for it. And those are from all over the world. And we run those on 8-week cycles. So we're really looking at 50 people, probably 4 times a year going through these. So that's 200 people through that right there. And that's small compared to the Desert Stream, the Living Waters programs. I don't know how many of those there are right now. I know we have quite a few here in Kansas City, but they're spread all over the country. And ministering to people just seeking healing. And I think it's important too to recognize that it doesn't have to be same-sex attraction. One of the great things for us who experience same-sex attraction is getting into a room with a woman who experiences a porn addiction or promiscuity and realizing that our core issues are sort of the same and our need for Jesus is sort of the same. There's nothing like, there's no scarlet G on my right. shirt.
But, well, and you know, that's the other part of the born gay myth. One of the things that it's done is to set people apart. And really what Desert Stream is doing is to say, your struggle is not unique. And, you know, in one sense of the word, that can be, you can view that as being comforting and inviting and welcoming. On the other hand, you can look at it as like, get over yourself. You're not the only person on planet Earth with this problem. Stop already, you know? I mean, because we're broken humans and we kind of need to, to be kicked from both directions sometimes.
Right,
so
are
there, Christy, are there any final words that you'd like to share with our audience of followers here at the Ruth Institute?
Well, I hope that this time really has been a time to impart hope. There is so much happening. There's so much to be concerned about with, you know, legal issues, with social issues, with the emergence of the side B. There's so much to like be afraid of. But in reality, on the ground, there is so much hope. Jesus is the God who transforms. And I really feel like I look at my life and I think about the years and the people who invested in me over the years, all of whom carried hope for what I was called to be. And I think it's really important for us as a Christian community, no matter what interfaith we ascribe to remember that Jesus has stamped his image in us and he wants to redeem that image in all of us and that he can. And I feel like it's really important just to know that there is hope, no matter where someone is, no matter what they're, how far off from their true self they've gotten, there is always hope because Jesus wins. So I just really feel like I'm hoping that this time that we've had together has been a time just to maybe instill some of that hope, knowing that God can do really, truly amazing things. And it's worth it to fight for the freedom of our brothers and sisters who struggle. So,
well, Christie May Jesse, I have no doubt at all that this interview and this conversation is going to be a source of hope to a lot of people and that many people are going to be blessed by this conversation. And I want to thank you so much for being my guest on today's episode of the Dr. J Show.
It's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you so much.